Oh, it does. It does. It neutralizes the green tea.
Right.
But there's plenty of green. She's still staring at it.
There you know.
Yeah, well, you saw the boots I had on.
The boots I had on last Sunday.
I put that down next to the blue to match that green. And that's a gray green because, you know, it's kind of a dullish green. Which is okay because I wear those a lot and they're not
green. Do you think the word green is just kind of freaking you out? Like, it's not green. You know what I mean?
But you can't
like it.
No. Green's my favorite.
I like the gray green.
Although Chris is up here now. Last time I saw him, he was putting these pepperoni cheese. Yeah, well, he made the coffee and stuff. It's phrased, I hate that term for this group, but anyway, it's the Human Resources Committee. He's to be pastor and staff. Well, no, he's not on the committee.
I know.
But the Human Resources Committee is only like 3 people. So they ask it. They don't touch anything.
Good morning.
Good morning,
and welcome to the Guilford Community Church, and welcome to those who are watching on Facebook and later YouTube, including my wife, Cindy. She's down in Florida visiting her friend, Sandy, so I hope you're watching. We'll give you a little test on the sermon after the service. If you're seated near the center of the aisle, please sign our registration book. If you're visiting and would like to be included on the church email network, please include your email when you sign in. It is the first Sunday of the month, and as is our custom, we gather around the Lord's table at the close of the service, a table open to everyone present. Immediately following our service, please join us downstairs in our fellowship hall for coffee hour. This morning's coffee hour is hosted by our Human Resources Committee. Also, Judy Cook will be holding a Reiki session in the gathering room, which is located right outside of the sanctuary. And there will be a meet and greet. If you've been coming for some time and would like to learn a little bit more about the church, perhaps even explore membership, there will be a meet and greet next Sunday after church. And then we're going to switch the order of the last two hymns. The board is correct, though. But the bulletin, I made a mistake in that. And I know that Amber has a couple of announcements to make.
Good morning, everyone. This Friday, we will be doing a youth night out, or adults, if you would like to join. We're going to do a movie night downstairs with Ice Cream Sundays. And so that's Friday night, this coming Friday night, from 6 to 8. The other thing is that we are having our annual Super Bowl Sunday next week, and if you would like to take part in that, we're asking for everyone to bring in canned soup on that day. The children will collect it and we'll be able to help the Guilford Gut Lunch program to give the soup to them. So that's for next week, and yeah, that's it.
Thank you, Amber. Now just take a moment to reflect on why we've gathered here today. Thank you, Dan and AJ. Please stand and join me in our call to worship. In every act of creating,
we experience the sacred dimension of life.
In all that is truly human, in the midst of pain and destruction,
we experience the sacred dimension of life.
In new life, in nature, in other human beings, and in the recesses of my own spirit,
we experience the
whenever there is the spirit of life, love, and empowerment,
we experience the sacred dimension of life.
But above all, in the mystery beyond all other mysteries,
we experience the sacred dimension of life.
And then remain standing as we sing together hymn number 28, For the Beauty of the Earth.
Oh,
please be seated and join me in a word of prayer. Having greeted and welcomed those around us, we pause now to center on all that is good, on all that we know is worthy. May we focus attention on the richness of truth. May our souls be restored for life's journey. To all that is worthy, to all we believe is true, all that we deeply hold precious, we commit ourselves anew. Even as we repeat the words that Jesus taught his disciples long, long ago, a prayer that began, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Today's reading is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about it. So he went to her, took her hand, and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. That evening, after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him. And when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in the synagogues and driving out demons. This is today's gospel.
Thank you.
you, choir. That was great. And if the children come forward, you're going to have your time with Amber this morning.
Morning. Can you believe that we started a new month this week? It's February already. I can't believe it. So that means we need to have a new focus. And our focus for this month is going to be on kindness, because February 11th to February 17th is Random Acts of Kindness Week. And it's a wonderful occasion that happens every single year, even though we should be kind all months. It's a wonderful week that really devotes to kindness. And we encourage people to spread love, compassion, positivity, and little acts of kindness can go a long way. Now, I want everyone, including adults right now, to turn to someone, turn to your neighbor, and say something kind to them right now. Go ahead. All right. Now, our words can be very powerful. So our words can be very powerful, but also our actions can be very powerful. Now, did everybody get a kindness card? If you did, hold it up. If you need one, just raise your hand and we can come get you one. Okay. Reed, can you go give your mom one real quick? Oh, we got a couple more people over there. Can you grab those and give them? Because they need their kindness cards. Now, this kindness card is going to be a reminder for you. You can put it in your wallet. You can put it on your bureau, you can put it on your desk, you can put it in your purse, but this kindness card is going to help you throughout this month. Now, there are some things on here that you can do today, you can do this week, you could do this month, and it's as easy as saying, can I help you with something? Or can I lend a hand? What can I be grateful for? Those are different things that you can do to help someone out. Okay? Now, here's the challenge, the church challenge. I am challenging all the adults in here and the kids to do at least one random act of kindness each week. And then during coffee hour, you're going to report to the Sunday school and we're going to create a kindness board. And we're going to shoot for 75 different acts of kindness in the month of February. And at the end, we're going to see how many we actually complete. But don't forget to tell us during Sunday school and look out for that kindness table, because we'll be down there. So good luck to everybody. And you don't have to do just what's on this card. You can think outside the card and try to do a kind of actness every single week. Okay? All right. Let's head down to Sunday school.
Mind if I tell you a secret? A few simple truths about me. Might be hard to believe. Guess I'm just trying to come clean. Sometimes I don't know where I'm going. It's hard to admit where I've been. When I come to the end of myself, this is where I begin again. I am here. I am loved. God is good. And that's enough. I don't know your situation, what kind of story you're in, if you're high on that mountain or down in the valley again. You might be holding your baby, or you might be holding a drink. You might be holding a secret that's getting harder to keep. But you are here, you are loved, God is good, and that's enough. And I am here, I am loved. And that's enough. It's okay if I don't have the answers. It's okay to be right where you are. It was patience and kindness and love that got us this far. You are here. You are loved. God is good. And I am here. I am loved. God is good. And that's enough. He is here. He is love. God is good. And that's enough.
Thank you, Stacy. That was very nice. And kind of thinking about what Amber was thinking about what Amber encouraged us, probably the two kindest words in the English language, great sermon. I do have, on a serious note, a couple of prayer concerns to share with you. Bob Jackson has been in and out of the hospital. He was supposed to come home Monday. He did come home, but then has spent some time back and forth from the hospital. So please hold Bob and Lyndon your thoughts and prayers. And then really sad news, early this week, Betsy Bright lost her husband, Jim. Jim had a massive heart attack while he was skiing in Colorado and died. Betsy right now is with her son in Oregon and will be coming back here with her daughter sometime in March. And Sue Belanger and her husband are here as well this morning, and we just want to hold all of you in our hearts. So let us be in a spirit of prayer. As we quiet ourselves for a moment of prayer and reflection, the question we're invited to ponder is never what do we expect God to do, but what can we do? How can we respond to what life is handing us right now? May we act upon the thoughts that have come to mind in this moment of quiet. May we always be thankful for the gift of love, love which has created us and restores us, love that links us to others in struggles and in joy. We give thanks, too, for the spirit of creativity that inspires and encourages, that brings forth new things, surprises us in the midst of life's ordinariness. In all of our adequacy and inadequacy, may we always be a caring people. In all of our strength and all of our weakness, may we be true to our best selves. In our happiness and sadness, may we search for the best ways to respond to life. This is our prayer. Amen. And then stand as we sing together hymn number 495, Called as Partners in Christ's Service. When I got back to my office a couple of weeks ago, there was a note on my desk. Melissa had written, Craig Pritchard called. He said he was an old friend from high school. He'd love it if you'd call him. My mood went immediately from happy to kind of frustrated, irritated. I hadn't thought about Craig in decades. We'd kind of been friends in high school, kind of. Most of my friends were jocks. Not Craig. He was kind of nerdy, in fact. Kind of like Warren was in high school. Now, had we not gone to the same church, we probably wouldn't have been friends, but both of our mothers planned lots of activities for us to do together, and at some point in high school, inspired by our youth minister, Craig suggested the two of us start a Bible study group before school. He convinced me to help. Now, we never had more than 4 or 5 students, but we faithfully met, we studied the Bible, and we prayed for other students, other godless students. We prayed that we might have opportunities to lead them to the Lord, share our faith. So I thought about all these things as I got ready to call Craig. We hadn't talked. I hadn't even thought about him in probably 45 years. You see, I didn't really want to call him back. I'm not the same person I was in high school. I was a real Bible thumper back then. Back in high school, we would have called a guy like I am today wishy-washy, maybe a godless heretic. So I put the call off for a couple of days, but eventually I mustered up the courage and I called him. I knew I was in trouble when he greeted me this way, "Brother, it's good to hear from you." He said he bumped into my sister while he was on a business trip back in Michigan. He found out what I was doing, and he was so excited to discover that I was a man of God, a pastor doing God's work. He was, as we would have said back in the day, on fire for the Lord. He only knew. The call was so painful. Painful because I just didn't feel I could be honest with him. Tell him that what I had experienced in life, what I learned in seminary and graduate school, those things have changed the way I see myself, how I see God in the world. Coward that I am, I hemmed and hawed, trying to be as ambiguous as possible. Tried changing the subject a few times. "How about those lions?" I said. After about 20 minutes, we hung up, but not before he suggested, "Why don't my wife and I come out for a visit?" Now every Sunday, I worry. But that phone call got me thinking about how I have and how we have changed over the years. Certainly all of us have physically changed, haven't we? When I see a picture of myself from when I started 22 years ago, I can't believe how young I used to be. But probably even more than my physical appearance, my thinking has changed and evolved. How about you? You see the world the same way you did 40 or 50 or 60 years ago. How has your faith evolved? Now, most of us start off with a very literal black and white faith. We believe what authority figures tell us. Wouldn't think to challenge that. And at some point, Mr. Hill, long life's journey, we begin to question what authority figures like pastors tell us. In the church, they told us that Jesus is the only way. But as our life has unfolded, we've met Jews and Buddhists and Muslims and atheists who live every bit as good a life as we do. Our faith in the good book has been challenged, and often as we mature, what we know about the world to be true doesn't square what the good book taught us, at least at a literal level. And some of us move on. We become members of the Church Alumni Society. We don't become outspoken critics of the church. It's just that its message no longer captivates us or our modern minds and imaginations. And some of us even have a nasty breakup with God, become quite outspoken. But sometimes, probably a lot of us here, we go through another stage. where we come to appreciate some of the stories in the Bible not as literally true, but stories with a good point to make. Stories that suggest life, our life, has meaning and purpose. A work of fiction doesn't need to be true to be powerful. Our gospel passage, I think, is a good example. Back in high school, I would have read that story with great eagerness at the power that Jesus displayed. He speaks the word and demons cower, the lame walk, the blind see. At that time, I believed with all my heart that if I prayed hard enough, that I could do the things that Jesus did. But then there came a time in my life when I was very close to where Thomas Jefferson was. I would have been quite happy to cut out all those miracle stories of the Bible. But along the way, I came to see things from a different perspective, not as true or false, historical or not. And I also fully recognize that the Bible was not written with us in mind. But still, those stories capture what was important to Jesus. The Jesus we meet in the Gospel of Mark is one fully 100% invested in this world, helping people to flourish here and now. We never once hear Jesus say, if you are suffering now, don't worry. Things will be better when you die. He never once said, if you want to get to heaven, believe this. But he did say, if you do this, earth will become a lot more heaven-like. So a story like we read this morning, Brenda read for us, doesn't ask me to believe that it really happened. But it invites me to ask myself, what can I do to bring wholeness, wellness to my community? How can I help others to flourish and to live abundantly? Early this last week, I met with a lady who will bury her 37-year-old son on Tuesday. He'd been homeless for some years. He was found frozen in Concord. She's haunted by that image of her son discovered frozen. She's filled with a little bit of guilt. 40 years ago, had I met that lady, I would have held her hand and prayed with her. I might have even said the most God-awful thing we can say. It must be God's will. Maybe I would have quoted a Bible verse. Last week, I didn't do any of those things. I just listened and told her to come back next week. And then on Friday, a young man stopped by my office saying his family needed food. Could we do anything? I brought him to the food pantry, had him fill up a couple of bags. I gave him a gift card to Vista that our outreach committee had left with me. I told them about our Got Lunch program, the Friendly Kitchen, Isaiah Cafe 661, hands across the table. I may not be able to heal the sick or quiet the minds of the mentally troubled, but I can help people. We can all help people discover the resources available in our community. I may not be able to make the lame walk, but I can make darn sure that our building is handicap accessible. And in doing those things, we have the same power that Jesus did to lift the brokenhearted, to love the unloved, to touch the untouchable. At my best, at our best, we should focus not on what we can't do, but what we always can do. So we can always support policies and politicians that take seriously the plight of people on the margins. We can write checks to agencies doing that important work, doing those things that we can't personally do. And when we do those things, we inch ourselves closer and closer to creating a community of kinship where no one is excluded. It's been years, probably 3 decades, since I closed my eyes and prayed that God might do something. Now when I pray, I'm searching myself, asking myself, what can I do? To pray for the sick is to commit myself to making sure people have access to health care, checking in on them, coordinating rides and meals. To pray for the hungry is to participate in endeavors that feed the hungry. It's to ask this question: why in the most affluent country to ever exist, why are there hungry people? When we do those things, as this church does day after day, we live out the words of the hymn that we'll close our service with, a hymn that AJ introduced us to a number of years ago, a hymn I love. You need my hands, my exhaustion, working love for the rest of the weary, a love that's willing to go on loving. Oh, Jesus, you have looked into my eyes, kindly smiling. You called out my name. On the sands, I have abandoned my small boat. Now with you, I will seek other seas. So let us all abandon that small, puny boat of a literal religion, a religion that delights in labeling and thinks it has all of the answers, so that together we might seek out other seas. Amen. We gather now around a table that reminds us that love is always costly. Jesus' life wasn't about the forgiveness of sins, but a life lived completely sacrificially for all of us. And so we gather around the table mindful of the story that is behind it, that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and said, "My body will be broken like this." And then he took a cup filled with ordinary wine, said, "This cup symbolizes a new covenant sealed with my life. When you drink it, do so remembering me." So ministering in his name, we offer to you the bread of life. And together, let us eat the bread of life. And now, in the name of the crucified Jesus, but the ever-living, ever-present Jesus Christ, we offer to you the cup of the new covenant. Together, let us taste and know the goodness and love of the Lord. Having finished the supper, the disciples departed, singing a psalm. Please stand as we close our service, singing hymn number 173, "We Have Come Down to the Lakeshore." And now, having gathered together for worship, may we go forth with a great spirit of kindness, humility, and curiosity. Amen.